Mikoláš.
I am working for the Czech University of Life Sciences in Prague, the Department of Ecology, and also for the NGO Prales, that you maybe know from the maps of the forests of Slovakia that is available on our websites. I will present to you basic information about the wilderness in Slovakia. This presentation was prepared with cooperation with Jan Kadlečík, who could come finally at, with Jan Kopercer. Slovakia is situated in the central part of the Western Carpathians, so we can say that the core areas of the Western Carpathians are inside of Slovakia. Western Carpathians are considered as biodiversity hotspots since, for example, the large carnivores, original population of large carnivores such as brown bear, lynx, or wolves are still living here. And we can talk about wild populations. Also, on the left side, you can see Capercaillie, that is typical old growth forest specialist in the Carpathians. And in the Western Carpathians, it's surviving one of the largest Central European populations of this rare species. Some of the largest primary forest remnants of European Union are found in Slovakia. For example, on this picture you can see one forest where you can where we measured pine trees older than 1,000 years in Cemura. So this is really unique for the European standards. Can you imagine that we still have forests where trees can reach more than 1,000 years? Some of the primary forests, especially the beech-dominated, are recognized by the UNESCO. They are recognized as the UNESCO World Heritage. So we can say that the Western Carpathians or in the Slovakia, you can still find all or almost all the important elements for the Central European wilderness. Most of these, let's say, wilderness elements we can still find here, especially because of the inaccessibility of the terrain and because of the historical development. There were not so many roads in the mountainous regions of Slovakia in the past, and that's why we still can find some rare habitats and species that you, some of them you can't find in the Western Europe. How is the country strategy on natural processes protection? So there is actually no specific national strategy or legal instrument on natural processes protection. Protection of natural processes is not defined in any nature protection law. And actually, there are several degrees of protection or levels of protection in Slovakia, from 1 to 5, and only the strict reserves with degree or level of protection 5 allow the possibility to protect the natural processes. There was prepared a national biodiversity strategy that includes some measures on maintenance of so-called virgin forests and increasing of the area of natural forests, preventing fragmentation and support of forest regeneration, protection of forest habitats and species. However, there are no any real sanctions, so in the practical world this doesn't work very well. So as I mentioned, only the strict reserves or strictly protected reserves that are the highest level of protection in Slovakia allow the protection of natural processes, but also only to a limited extent. Responsibility lies within the Ministry of Environment of Slovak Republic, and the protection is initiated by state nature conservation and NGOs. The problem of the strict reserves is that they are usually very small and very fragmented. On this map you can see with the red color, those are strict reserves with area over 1,000 hectares. So you can see there are only a few of them, and most of them with the green color, are shown the strict reserves with area smaller or less than 1,000 hectares. So many of reserves have area, let's say 100, 200 hectares. They are fragmented. So this is very difficult also from the point of view of management, some buffer zones, and also for the biodiversity. These reserves are simply too small to sustain many species. These are the areas that allow us to protect natural processes recently, but as I have mentioned, is not always the case. This is an example from High Tatra Mountains. That is the only national park that almost fulfills the IUCN criteria for the national park. With the green color, you can see the borders of strict reserves. And as you know, in 2014, we had a large windrows fall by bark beetle outbreaks. And of course, salvage logging was conducted. But salvage logging was conducted also in the strict reserves. So the red color shows the salvage logging inside of the strict reserves. According to this information, we have found 41 kilometers square of forest that have been salvaged within the reserves. And we, in over a 10-year period, and only 3.5% of naturally disturbed forest remained unsalvaged in total forest area of the national park. So even in the reserves, in case of windthrows, bark beetle outbreaks, it is possible to conduct salvage logging. So the strict reserves have area of approximately 1.91% of the country. It is important also to mention, as you can see on the previous graph, that inside of the reserve there are many peaks and cliffs, so many large area of the reserves is situated actually above the upper timberline. So that's why the percentage of the reserves is maybe relatively high to compared to some countries, but there is large proportion of the area is situated not in the forest but above the upper timberline, where there is no interest for almost any management. What is also important to mention, that many old-growth forests, so 35% of the old-growth forests in Slovakia are still not protected, so they are under threat of logging. And every year we lose actually some hectares of old-growth forests. This is one of the very bad examples, also from a national park, Nizhe Tatry Mountains or Low Tatra Mountains, where one old-growth forest or primary forests that have never been managed intensively in the past, with trees older than 400 years, was completely destroyed. So the situation is quite complicated. The improvement of protection of these sites and of, let's say, wilderness in general might be achieved by new nature conservation strategy. This new nature conservation strategy will bring in new terms, because as I mentioned, we didn't, that there are not defined wilderness or conservation or protection of natural processes is not yet defined in our legislation. So the new nature conservation strategy might help, however, it is still under preparation, and it is possible that it will be for a long time under preparation, because it already should be accepted in 2016, so we will see. What is the relation between natural processes protection and protected areas? So I have to say that the relation is very weak. Out of 9 national parks, only Tatra National Park is close to fulfill the criteria of IUCN category 2. This is a picture from the Low Tatra Mountains, that is also a national park, and you can see that logging, large scale, clear cutting conducted in the form of salvage logging, or there are different ways and possibilities that can be used by the forestry administration to do clear cuts like this, even in the national parks. Very important role in the nature conservation and protection of the natural processes play the NGOs, because without the NGOs and some active scientists, even within most of the strict reserves, large-scale salvage logging would be conducted. And actually, I have to say that only thanks to, or especially thanks to this sector, we really can see some positive, really positive reserves, such as Ticha and Koprova Valley in High Tatra Mountains, that has more than 10,000 hectares. And the natural processes are dynamic and shaping the habitats. So this is especially a result of work of the NGOs. However, the regional and local national authorities prefer rather, let's say, short-term economic benefits. So it's not easy to win some areas. There is now this table prepared by Jan Kablečík. So he tried to define the approach on different disturbances. Wildfire is actually not considered really natural disturbance for the Carpathians, or it's not a typical natural disturbance for the Carpathians. I would say that mostly there is regular elimination of this disturbance. Bark beetle, we write that it's case by case approach, but as I mentioned, only in reserves there is no elimination. However, in the other even protected areas, such as national parks, there is regular elimination on large spatial scales. With the invasive alien species, I think this fits well, case-by-case approach. And game management, I think only within the reserves it is not allowed to hunt. However, you can hunt on the borders of the reserves. So when the reserves are too small, let's say 100, 200, 400 hectares, and it is allowed to hunt directly on the borders, then it doesn't really work for the animals. Lessons learned so far and recommendations. So the biggest problem, the recent biggest problem in destruction of the wilderness areas is salvage logging. And as all of you know, extensive high severity disturbances have affected Central European forests, and actually it's predicted increase in the frequency and severity of these disturbances. So this is really a hot issue, because in most of the protected areas, not only in Slovakia but also in Romania and other countries, large-scale salvage logging have substantially diminished thousands of hectares of old forests and fragmented habitats. So this is a picture from a national reserve or strict reserve in the High Tatra Mountains. You can see how nicely the bark beetle is opening the forest canopy and creating kind of patchy dynamics that allows the light to penetrate the floor and increases the ground vegetation cover, and many light-depending species profit from these conditions. Also, the natural disturbances provide deadwood that is habitat for many endangered species. But as I said, the salvage logging has here completely destroys and homogenized the landscapes. This is picture from National Park Muránska Planina. It's just on the borders with strict reserve. This is picture from National Park Low Tatra Mountains from the year 2007. You see that there is still a lot of forest, many of the forests you can see was the best or one of the best primary spruce forests in all the Western Carpathians. Amazing habitats. Recently it looks like this. So it's really fast. It's very fast, and there is not much time left because every year we lose a lot. So of course the biodiversity reacts on this, and just an example of capercaillie, because I studied a lot this species. So we did a model. Most of you probably know capercaillie is considered an indicator of natural forest, of species-rich habitats, and in the Carpathians the best habitats are old-growth forests. So we did the model for the entire Carpathians, and with the red color you can see the loss of habitats within the last 20 years. So here you can see Slovakia, so the red color shows logging in the habitats of capercaillie, and this is also Romania, so not only Slovakia, but actually entire Carpathians are under big pressure. Here is shown the situation in Slovakia in the 1970s. These are the population distribution or habitats of capercaillie in the 1970s. So the red color shows the more red are the polygons, the better is the connectivity of the habitat patches, and the more blue are the habitat patches, the less connected are the patches. So you can see that capercaillie, so this means that the natural forests were distributed on large areas in the Western Carpathians. The habitats were connected very well, and this is the recent situation. So the habitats became very fragmented because of the logging of old and natural forests. Of course, the population decreased since 1972. It decreased by 76%. It is really a lot. So I'm mentioning this because capercaillie is considered an indicator of let's say healthy environment and natural forests. So it somehow reflects what's going on with the mounting biodiversity in general. So based on these facts, conservation actions to help the rapid biodiversity declines are urgently needed, and the reserves are too small to sustain many species, such as capercaillie, and the reserves are too small and too fragmented. So we recommend adapting policies to protect natural forests, limiting large-scale clear-cutting and salvage logging, restricting road building, and reduce the forest fragmentation. The biggest threat in protected areas is the salvage logging, and there are several reasons for increased disturbance severity, many people ask or think that this is a result of climate change. Because of the global warming, the disturbances, the disturbance frequency and intensity increased, and that it is not natural for our forests, and that the forest cannot regenerate, let's say, by itself, that it's not, let's say, something healthy for the environment. And because of this reason, because there was no any scientific background how it was in the past in the Western Carpathians, if there occurred such a large-scale events like in 2004 or in 2014, or if it is only the recent situation result of global warming. So that's why we conducted dendrochronological research in old-growth forests, so in forests that have never been managed, that have been affected only by the natural disturbances. And we reconstructed the disturbance, natural disturbance history of these primary forests. Here is a map. For those who know Slovakia, you can see that we covered almost entire mountainous landscape. these are the plots. You can see that they are in High Tatra Mountains, Low Tatra Mountains, Great Fatra, Polana, up on the north there is Orava, Babia Hora and Bilsko. So we tried to cover entire landscape and to see how the disturbances have affected this landscape in the past. And the results are very interesting. So you can see in this graph the reconstruction of the disturbance history. So this is canopy disturbed per decade. And this peak is very interesting that shows that in period between 1850s to 1880s there was a strong period of high severity disturbances. So we can say that approximately 200 years ago similar events, similar large-scale high severity disturbances affected our forests. So disturbances like this are still within the range of natural variability. So based on these important facts, we suggest that management should recognize disturbances as natural part and even the large-scale disturbances as natural part of the ecosystem dynamics. And we also show that the ecosystems are able to recover naturally because there is already enough regeneration inside of these forests. One of the main problems that the current legislation and strategic documents do not define conservation of natural processes, as I mentioned already in the beginning of the presentation, and there are not any real sanctions. So even if they will define conservation of natural processes without any real sanctions, this will not work. So just to summarize this, what we see as one of the most important steps that can be done to protect the remaining wilderness is to define the targets for conservation of European wilderness and to implement legislative tools for conservation of European wilderness. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Was not so positive. So, do you have any questions to Mikoláš now? Or to Mario?
Maybe Mario has something to add.
Do you think about the idea which is that you say in Bavaria, Forest National Park, but in Schumacher, despite the disturbances, despite the bark beetle, just to take hands off? Then there are examples, then we see the rejuvenation is coming, the natural process in place, and we can ensure the habitats through non-intervention approach as well. Do you think it's possible? Because it was an appeal, help us stopping destroying habitats. How?
Yeah, so I think it is possible, but we have to think on large spatial scales. So as I mentioned, we have some reserves where now, let's say, we can more or less ensure the conservation of natural processes, but these areas are too small. But if we in Slovakia would establish core zones of national park, if we would do the zonation of national parks, actually, so I think we would solve a lot of these problems. And I think one of the issues that can help is also the definition of wilderness and kind of sanctions. If you define something as a wilderness, so there might be also some tool that that can help you to sustain this. And this we are still missing.
Because I think the Austrian approach sometimes definition and rules and even that the fine can be issues if you do not respect. This is one way, but the second way is like in Austria, it was like a movement, let me say, supported by National Park Association, NGOs, and the whole process. And now they have criteria, still obliged to have, as we've heard yesterday, not they are not obliged to have wilderness, but they are obliged to partly establish non-intervention zones. So it is like a movement and the process, I would say. It cannot come overnight with just the clear definition in the law, or, I don't know, it's a question.
Just maybe a short comment. Slovak society was completely not prepared what happened in Tatras. Because it happens very, very, almost 10 years ago, when the process of wilderness development in Europe was much, much younger. And everything was done legally, talking about the Tatra National Park, based on the existing legislation, which says this is a core zone, nobody should touch it. But then suddenly, ministry issued exceptions. And the result was what you have seen. And it's going on like that. So that for me, at least, that was actually the signal that even existing legislation, relatively good done, it works in the past 30 years very well. And I'm not talking about the restitution, the reprivatization process. Existing legislation system worked very well for 30, 40 years. And then suddenly, because society was not prepared, including foresters and nature conservationists, everything changed. Ministry put the stamp, nobody says no, go there. And you have seen this excellent animation, how the fast this logging move on, and it's still going on like that. Last 10,000 hectares of untouched forest in Tatra National Park was protected because of public protest, not because of professional nature conservationists, not because of individual foresters, but because of public protest, NGO, few people simply stand up and said, this is against the law, and this is against us, this is against the capital, etc., etc., and the protest was not massive. Immediately in the TV, suddenly 10,000 hectares were saved like that. Max.
And then that's the big danger that we have as Netherlands. I mean, you all have heard about the protests concerning the illegal logging in Romania. In reality, the biggest problem is the legal logging, the legal deforestation. We are part of this European Beach Forest Network, and there was a colleague who is a lawyer and his brother is a judge, and they're publishing a paper now who has shown that in Romania, virgin forest, you can legally log with these so-called exceptions. And the system of protection always works when the sun is shining. The moment it wanes, forget any protection measures that we think we have. So the real challenge is changing the forest law to get rid of these exceptions. In Romania, they call it conservation logging. But you can do clear cut in a virgin forest, legally. And it is happening.
Okay.
Question, maybe a naive question. I know that Natura 2000 is not the optimal instrument for wilderness, but these changes you have shown, these are absolutely tremendous. And are they not in serious conflict with Natura 2000 regulation? I assume that parts of this area will be Natura 2000. Has it ever been tried to make a complaint to the EU about this? Because this is a scale that is certainly not compatible with EU regulation.
So we are putting actually right now a complaint to the EU with cooperation with also some other NGOs. But of course we do not have big expectations, but it might help to do something. So we will see. It's one part of the things we are trying to do, but as Vlado said, I think it's important that many people will protest or show that they really want nature and they don't want these large-scale exploitations. And the problem is that the logging is really so intensive that actually our timber harvest per year increased so much, so it's now is the harvest double compared to the sustainable yield. So the sustainable yield is 5.5 million cubic meters, and recently even the plant harvest already exceeded 10 million cubic meters. So it's doubled for the last 10 years. And the same is in Romania, actually. They also have doubled yield. So it's a complex problem. So I don't know if Natura 2000 really might, on the national level, it's not working. We will see how the European Commission will react on the complaint, but there must be many steps down to change something.
First large scale deforestation 10 years ago, and there was a case of infringement. But there we have any result.
So for the low Tatra mountains, it was also a complaint in 2007. Mariana Sik prepared it. And the answer was that they have to wait until the rare species disappear from some special protected areas. It was simply said the answer. So now it disappeared actually from some. So.
There are some others coming in, because then maybe it would be good to complement the whole picture by better subway from
you. Very short comment to Mr. your question. In our law, because I'm from Slovakia, in our law we have a state land which was added after we implemented Natura 2000 into our legislation, where it is said that the regular logging does not cause the harm to habitat. So therefore, you can see pictures like this in the Natura 2000 sites, because these national parks are for sure these SPAs and these. But this was just activity of foresters lobbying, because from my point of view, this system of Natura 2000 and the way how it was implemented in our country was completely, it's like a misunderstanding from the both sides, because for example, these beech forests, which cover a very large part of our country, they are officially all biotopes in this list of biotopes. So if we will try to apply this approach from Western Europe, I haven't been in a lot of countries, so I can't say what's the situation in Germany or whatever, how do forests look like there. I just traveled once to the train from Berlin to the Baltic Sea, so I saw something. So, for me, it looks like that in these Western countries, there are no so many natural forests. And if they are, they are rare and they deserve protection. But in our country, a huge amount of, or huge percentage of those forests are even in a state that they will deserve the protection. And when we apply your criteria on our forest, now we have 36% of the country is covered by some category of Natura 2000, but with no real protection.
So let me just add something to this comment, because I know a little bit of the situation in Slovakia for you commenting. I think the problem is that these forest management plans are prepared by foresters,
not the administration of national parks legally, and they are excluded from the procedure of appropriate assessment under the Habitats Directive. So they are not a part of it. You are not allowed legally to assess during the appropriate assessment procedure these management plans prepared by foresters, because it's somehow perceived that they should contribute to the conservation of the area. So the nature conservation is so weak in Slovakia that you, for example, in Tatra Mountains have just up to 20 people working in the administration of national park.
More.
And then you have more than 100-150 foresters. It's only the former administration of the forest. And if you are a nature conservationist working for the administration, you have to ask for permission foresters to go to the forest. So that's the case, that's why they are so weak protecting their areas, because they have so weak law about nature conservation, about their competences, but this is, in reality, it's not their competence to protect the area.
But this is a common topic in Romania. If you want to log a virgin forest, you must get a scientist to tell you that it is a bark beetle or whatever. Now comes the problem. That scientist, by law, has to have had his education 20 years ago under the Soviet system. So a young researcher like you cannot be asked to give a statement saying, no, stop marking. The law is tricked, you said, combated, in such a way that there is no way you can protect it if they want to log it.
By my opinion, after 2000 simply failed to protect wilderness, simply failed to protect the, because the natural process isn't subject of protection by Natura 2000. Of course, we see the examples in Šumava National Parks, Hakata National Parks, and other Slovak National Parks in the Bielovieža Forest. And we were also involved in complaints to the European Commission because of logging in Šumava National Park. Similarly, colleagues from Slovakia in the Hakata Mountains, and the European Commission tried to solve it somehow, not to finish the infringement, because they don't need an precedent case for the attitude to the mountain spruce stands. If they agree that there is that the South Savage logging because of bark beetle destroying the mountain spruce stands it's bad management for the mountain spruce stand. It would be an example for the other mountain spruce stands up in other countries in Europe where also bark are private and owned and so on, and they didn't want to have such an example and such as example of precedent decision.
I understand this way, but still, and I'm not over thinking about Natura 2000, but for example, the law you mentioned about the forestry had to decide on its own on the future of inhabitants, I think that alone would be a reason to have an infringement.
Yeah,
because at least in Austria, it was, when we joined the EU, it was necessary to harmonize all laws, even the forestry law, although it was done slowly, there'd be a lot of pressure from the NGO, but it has to be done. And so this alone would be a reason for having an infringement.
But now, this is something that should be under the infringement procedure, is a bad transposition, or not well done transposition of the Habitats Directive. I wouldn't say that Natura 2000 failed, because it was created in a certain period, more than 20 years ago, in a situation which was different, namely it was your countries. And now we are in a new situation, but we cannot say that because this tool was created in the 1990s, it failed. It didn't fail. It's not flexible. That's the problem.
If I can add, Natura is a good tool, but not for the wilderness or non-intervention
points.
That's the case.
Yeah. That's true, but I think it's already a problem for Natura 2000 without elements. So, Capercaillie is an important species, and so that alone would be a reason.